ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors of the ETF Store. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Jason will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
Welcome to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci and Jason Lank in studio. As always, thank you so much for joining us. We have a great show lined up today. Last week, Vanguard launched two ESG ETFs. ESG stands for Environmental, Social, and Governance. These are factors measuring how positively companies impact their stakeholders and society at large in different areas. We'll be joined momentarily by ETF.com's Drew Voris. We're going to take a deeper look at these Vanguard ETFs and also just talk more broadly about the future of ESG ETFs overall. We've said it before, for all of the media attention ESG seems to garner, the investor reception to ESG ETFs has been pretty lukewarm so far. And Jason, what I think is interesting here with these new launches, Vanguard's not the type to just throw ETF ideas at the wall and see what sticks, right? If they're making a decision to get involved in broad-based, socially responsible ETFs, clearly they think the investor demand is going to be there. And these new ETFs are extremely inexpensive, so cost isn't going to be an issue for investors, which I think perhaps it has been to at least some degree for other ESG ETFs. So I tweeted this out last week. I think this is going to be fascinating to watch. If these Vanguard ETFs don't get traction, I think you have to wonder if broad-based ESG ETFs are ever really going to catch on with investors.
I think that's a fair statement. You know, Vanguard has tremendous cachet and, you know, muscle with their brand. And if they can't do it, I don't know who can, frankly, but they're going to have some of the same, I guess, issues that all ETF providers in this space have had. What is ESG to the average investor? It's still defined so broadly and differently by different ETFs. And more generally, do investors want performance or do they want a feel-good story or something in between? And another question I think investors ask themselves or should is your brokerage account the best place to express your environmental, social concerns?
Which has always been my point.
Exactly. So is it more important to do it with dollar signs, or should you man a picket line or Twitter or Facebook or some other way of expressing your deeply held convictions? You know, fund flows, you mentioned, have been modest at best. So I know that the industry at large will be watching this launch to see how it unfolds.
Now, also on the program today will be Mark Esposito, CEO of Esposito Securities. This is really interesting. So Mark's company provides seed capital to new ETFs. In other words, they provide the money that helps new ETF launches get off the ground. And if you think about this, because of the unique structure of ETFs and the fact that they trade intraday on an exchange, an ETF actually needs to own the underlying securities before it can do that, right? If an ETF tracks an index of companies involved in robotics, well, the ETF needs to own those robotic stocks before it can trade. So who pays for that? Who provides the money to buy those stocks? Because if you're buying several million dollars worth of shares, most startup ETF companies don't have that kind of cash just lying around. So that's where Mark's firm comes into play. And we'll have Mark explain everything that goes on behind the scenes here. Then also later in the show, we'll be joined by Ryan Curlin, head of capital markets at Alpha Architect. So he recently wrote a piece that generated some buzz on social media. It was titled, Smart Beta is Officially Dead, but Not Forgotten. And I think this will be fun. So Ryan's on a mission to kill the term smart beta. And to be clear, he's not saying, quote unquote, smart beta ETFs themselves are dead. He just doesn't like this term. And we've talked about this before. If an ETF isn't smart beta, does that mean it's dumb beta, right? Is this term really just smart marketing? Because it has become sort of a catch-all for a bunch of different strategies. So I do think Ryan has a point here. I guess the question is, what's the alternative? Because to me, it's sort of like, you know, index funds or active funds. When you hear those terms, you at least have a starting point for understanding what you're looking at.
Different people define smart beta in different ways. And you're right, it has become this giant bucket catch-all for different sort of strategies. You know, another way to think of it is a sort of a hybrid between a rules-based or index approach and active management. But I think the word that became the buzz and the subject of this article you mentioned is smart. And that smart implies different things to different people. You know, are you a dumb investor if you don't use smart beta? It's interesting. To me, smart implies better, but I don't think that's true. To me, it means different beta. So it may be smarter, it may be better, it may be worse, it may be dumber, but it's different beta. And I think that's where we're going to go with this.
All right. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Let's start today by talking ESG ETFs with ETF.com's Drew Voris.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
People have been saying there are too many mutual funds since the 80s. For all the talk of smart beta, they haven't pulled in huge assets. The active managers are showing up in the ETF space.
Drew, so last week, Vanguard launched two broad-based ESG ETFs. There's a U.S. version and an international version. Of course, in typical Vanguard fashion, these launched at very low price points, 12 and 15 basis points, respectively. To begin with, can you just walk us through these ETFs at a high level and perhaps how they compare to some of the other broad-based ESG ETFs on the market?
Sure thing, Nate. Thanks for having me on the show. What's interesting, I think you have an interesting bookend show today, because I hate the term ESG as much as Ryan hates the term smart beta. I just don't think the common person understands what that means. We use it because it's easy. It's jargon. It's financial jargon. The ETF industry is plagued with acronyms that nobody understands. We talk in tickers. You know, you don't read the Wall Street Journal and read about Coke as K. It's Coke, Coca-Cola. So my overarching thing here is that I don't think it's been explained very well in terms of how we tag it. And you also just minced ESG and socially responsible, and some will argue those are two very different things. But I will walk you through these. I mean, you made a great point here. Vanguard has entered the space of the socially environmental, social, and governance space, which also could be argued as a three very different things. But nonetheless, coming in with the Vanguard ESG U.S. stock ETF, ESGV is the ticker, and an international model, as you referred to, Vanguard ESG International Stock ETF, VSGX. They track domestic and international companies that meet certain environmental and social governance criteria. And as you said, they come in very cheap, lowest in the market, 12 basis points for the domestic ETF and 15 basis points for the international. And there really is not a whole lot of difference between some of the more and bigger funds that are already out there. The biggest fund in the space is only about $1 billion, so there's a lot of room to run if you can. Just for context, though, the whole idea of social responsibility investing and this ESG, if you will, I hate to use the term, but is big in Europe, very big in Europe. And Vanguard also has a mutual fund that has some multi-billion dollars in it that kind of focuses on the same thing, and these two funds are meant to complement that fund, according to Vanguard, But nonetheless, as you mentioned, it'd be interesting to see how this works. I would also point out this is also part of an arsenal now that every ETF issuer wants, because new investors seem to be the ones that gravitate to this kind of thing more often. And you can argue whether or not you're sacrificing performance or not, Nate.
Drew, you mentioned something that I would completely agree with is an issue in this space, and that's just sort of this financial jargon, ESG, socially responsible. You have impact investing. And so I do think that causes some confusion among investors as to exactly what they're getting. But I'm curious, are there other reasons why you think ESG has been slow to catch on overall?
I don't know if it's been slow to catch on contextually. In the ETF space, yes. But as I said, there's mutual funds. You know, there's been these, you know, anti-vice funds for years. And there's also vice funds, right? Goes the other way. So my whole point, I guess, is that in the ETF space, it's small right now, but it's growing. This year alone, I think there's $8 billion in the space in the ETF industry, and it's seen something like $1.65 billion new flows this year. So percentage-wise, it's getting there. And I just, again, I think that, as you mentioned, watching this will be interesting with Vanguard. It's going to be years. Okay, this is not like, you know, the marijuana ETF or a Bitcoin ETF that everyone's just going to gravitate toward right away. It's a slow process, and it's just, again, it's just part of a lineup an ETF issuer now is probably feeling they should have.
Drew, this is Jason Lank. You mentioned that this is perhaps the launch of this fund might be compared to a golf bag where, you know, you need to fill out your lineup. If you don't have a putter or a driver, your bag's not complete.
Yep.
And this slides into a spot they didn't have. Are they pandering to millennials? I mean, are they looking at the geographics and the demographics and saying the customers we want in 5 or 10 years want this kind of stuff, so let's put it out there?
Well, I would say this with Vanguard. I don't know about others, but I don't think pandering's the right word. I think they're judicious when they launch things. I mean, Vanguard only has 78 ETFs, and that seems like a lot, but they come out with a real, you know, thought process. They have a platform that they can sell. So, and I think that's a great analogy on the golf bag. They're just going to have that there if you want it. I don't know if it'll be a push. And the other thing, too, just to go back to this whole reference of ESG, people know if you say to somebody, here's a fund that's going to invest in the S&P 500, people know exactly what that is. People know what a small cap is. You know, it's a little riskier, but you can also get a bigger upside. So it's just like with smart beta, I can't wait to hear Ryan talk, but it's just something that's very hard to explain to the common person. And institutionally, sure, but I think sometimes there's a gap between marketing in that respect.
Well, and Drew, I think, you know, along those lines, you mentioned the term vice or anti-vice earlier. These two Vanguard ESG ETFs, they use exclusionary screens in this process, right? So they're eliminating companies involved in adult entertainment, alcohol, tobacco, weapons, gambling, those sorts of things. Do you think that matters in terms of inclusionary versus exclusionary screens in terms of what the end investor wants? Because I feel like with the exclusionary screens, we look at these broad-based ESG ETFs, you know, you are taking something like the S&P 500 or the Russell 1000 and then just backing out some of these companies involved in these businesses versus targeting specific social causes. Does that matter?
Well, first of all, I would just repeat that the Vanguard funds here are not very much different than any others in terms of what they're excluding. And it's almost similar to smart beta. So they're taking screens, whether it be value, momentum, et cetera, and just trying to sort. So once you start sorting out from the broad market, you're starting to slice and dice. So to me, that's riskier. Market returns seem to have done pretty well lately. If you want to feel better about your investment, more power to you. And you mentioned impact shares that just launched another fund based on the NAACP charity. They have a woman's fund. There's She out there from State Street. So there are funds that are out there that are investing in large cap funds. But as you said, it's a screen. So So you have to understand what you're screening out and screening in, just like you will as Ryan, I'm sure we'll talk about smart beta.
Yeah, impact shares I find interesting because they're set up as a nonprofit, and then they direct all of their net fees from the ETFs back to those specific causes. So you mentioned they have an NAACP ETF. There's a women's empowerment ETF. I believe actually just yesterday they launched an ETF that's affiliated with the United Nations. So I wonder if that model might work better just because the end investor feels like they're supporting a specific cause. But Drew, we'll have to leave it there. As always, appreciate the time. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, guys.
That was ETF.com's Drew Voris. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll go behind the scenes on seeding new ETFs with Mark Esposito, CEO of Esposito Securities. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime, Nate Geraci and Jason Lankin studio. Our next guest today occupies a fascinating area within the ETF universe, and one that doesn't receive a whole lot of attention, and that's providing seed capital for new ETFs. So if you think about this, without any initial investment dollars into a new ETF, that ETF simply can't come to market because it won't own anything. It won't own the underlying securities. Well, Esposito Securities is a firm that provides that initial funding to allow an ETF to buy those securities and help get the ETF off the ground. We are very pleased to be joined today by the CEO of Esposito Securities, Mark Esposito. Mark is on the line with us from Dallas. Mark, a pleasure having you on the program.
The pleasure's mine. Thanks for having me. Good morning.
Mark, my guess is many of our listeners probably aren't familiar with this process that goes on behind the scenes in terms of seeding ETFs. So to begin with, can you just first explain what exactly it means to seed an ETF and then walk us through why it's needed, why this is so important?
Well, like you said, in order for an ETF to come to market, it has to have assets in it. Statutorily, that's usually mandated by the SEC at $2 million or $2.5 million. And so we, in certain cases and for certain reasons, provide that capital to the issuer in order to help launch their product and help grow it.
And is that typically the number, that $2 to $2.5 million?
Yeah, I mean, the gold standard is $25 a share, which makes it, you know, $2.5 million because it's 100,000 shares that need to come to market. There have been several that have launched with $2 million and some with $1.5 million at the $20 and $15 number, respectively. But $25 is traditionally the gold standard, especially for equity ETFs.
All right. So from your standpoint, if you're putting up $2 to $2.5 million, what does your risk look like here? Do you always hedge the underlying market risk? And then what happens if an ETF simply doesn't make it?
Those are two great questions. Let me answer the first one. Yeah, so our goal is to try to remain dollar neutral and hedge our portfolio and have little to no risk, which is hard because ETFs have a lot of stocks in them. So to fully replicate the index is expensive and time-consuming. That product in our suite is really a loss leader for us. So we just do our best there. Sometimes we can hedge with the underlying stock specifically. Sometimes we have to replicate with other asset classes like other ETFs or futures or treasuries or options. So that's how we handle our book. We try to keep it dollar neutral and keep it low risk as possible. And then if the fund doesn't take off, well, that's a conversation we got to have with the issuer. It's been rare for us because we do so much homework on the front side. We look at about 25 data points, inclusive to how the ETF is going to be marketed and sold to the public in order to make those decisions. And hopefully our decisions are quality decisions, meaning that the fund is successful and you know, grows an AUM to $100 million.
Mark, is there a certain time frame that you look to get out of that that seed phase, or have an ETF get out of that seed phase and get your capital back? Is it a time frame? Is it a certain asset level for the ETF?
Yeah. Well, look, we'd love to be out first day. That's ideal. But that doesn't always happen. I'd say our average hold period is about a month, give or take. Some are longer, some are a day. We had one last week, ticker symbol TRTY, that had a lot of investors come in the first day, and so we were out the first day of trading.
Mark, this is Jason Lang. To me, the million-dollar question is, how do you decide which ETFs to seed? And you mentioned that you're looking at over 25 data points. Give me an example of something, a characteristic that you require to be a part of the ETF. And maybe on the other side, what do you not – an example of something you don't want to see?
Well, look, we're in the business to grow relationships over decades. And so holistically, we look at it first as a relationship with the issuer. Do we know them? Do we trust them? Have we worked with them before? And then secondarily, what's the sales proposition of the fund itself, and how can they distribute that, market that, radio that, TV that? You know, how are they going to sell that product to the public, and is it going to be successful? If it's just a Me Too product, that's not ideal. We look for, you know, good thematic first to market plays. We look at issuers who have had success in the past, and we look at, you know, the whole package. It's very all encompassing. Sometimes it's more than 25 data points, and we pass on a lot of new issues. And so we've as a firm, we've got to be very selective and intelligent about what we do, and we spend a lot of time on that.
And for our listeners, some of the ETFs that have recently been seeded by Esposito Securities include the Impact Shares, NAACP Minority Empowerment ETF, ticker NACP, the NYSE Pickens Oil Response ETF, which was launched earlier this year, Boone, and then last year, the AI-powered equity ETF, AIEQ, which has had a lot of success. It has over $200 million invested in it. Mark, outside of firms such as yourself, how do ETFs typically get seeded?
There's several different ways, and we prefer ours not to be the first way. It's always better if you have a natural seed provider that wants to be a long-term shareholder, i.e. a pension, endowment, or just a generic investor. We have several RIAs who have launched who have client demand out of the gate, and so they may get $50 million into the fund in the first week. That's a big part of it, more along the lines of something we would refer to as self-seeding. That's a big one. We love that. We help people get to that place. It's part of our process and product offering. So that's one way. The second is with street capital like ours. And then the third way is just through investor demand, creating units in the ETF.
Mark, we now have, over 2,200 ETFs on the market in the U.S. I'm curious, how difficult is it for a new ETF to find that seed capital, and has it become more difficult?
Yeah, I think over the past 18 months, it's become more difficult. Wall Street firms have trimmed their balance sheet. There's been some mergers and acquisitions that have affected players in that space, which has caused less seed capital to be available. And look, capital is expensive, and it's getting more expensive with interest rates rising, right? So that puts the onus upon us to just be that much more intelligent about what we do. I think it will continue to get harder going forward.
If it has become perhaps a little more difficult for ETFs to find that seed capital, do you think that's something that has the potential to stunt ETF growth or innovation at all, or do you not see it as, you know, that significant of an issue?
Yeah, I haven't seen that occur yet, because the best ideas will always get funded, right? But what I have seen is some not so well thought out ideas not come to market. And that's actually good for all parties, because the last thing anyone wants to do is have to shut down an ETF, which takes place all the time. And so in the past few years, there's been almost as many ETFs closing as opening. And so maybe that's a natural part of the process that's actually good.
Mark, you mentioned that your firm isn't really interested in Me Too ETF launches. Do you continue to see creative and interesting ideas come across your desk? Or, you know, is the ocean just kind of gotten full and most of the good ideas are out there already?
No, we see new creative ideas, and that's what makes it so exciting to be in this business and this product line, is that we get to see things first a lot of times. So there's still room in the index space and a lot of thematic plays. I think there's huge room because of the upside in AI and robotics. I think those are two areas. I think there's some asset-specific and country-specific things that can be done in the index space. And then, you know, really the active ETF space is uncharted and unconquered. And so that has huge upside. And I think once people figure out how to do that intelligently, that will be the next huge wave of growth. And options, you know, have come into a lot of portfolios and help grow that space as well.
We're visiting with Mark Esposito, CEO of Esposito Securities. They help seed new ETFs. Mark, going back to the amount of seed capital necessary to launch an ETF, would it make any difference if more money was pumped into a new launch? So in other words, if an ETF is seeded with, I don't know, $50 million, does that give it a better chance of success than an ETF seeded with $2.5 million? Just because investors might then perceive that ETF as being more successful, right, having more assets?
The generic answer is yes. And the reason why is that people do see that as safer and better, and there's more interest. Also, the wirehouses will put it on platforms at 50 or 100 million so that the brokers can buy it. So there's these thresholds for assets under management where you can get more investor interest just based on, you know, safety and running the fund at a much higher level. If the fund's too small, you know, people do have concerns about that. No one wants to be the only owner of an ETF, right?
Mark, we have just a few minutes left here. I'm curious, how did you get into this business?
Well, look, I've been on Wall Street 26 years, and I started Esposito Securities 12 years ago. And really, at the bequest of my clients in the ETF space, we started providing value-add products and services. And so we've just grown it from there. I mean, it's all client-centric, built on trust. That's what Esposito's hallmark is. And so we'll just keep providing services that are underserved by the bulge bracket firms in order to help our clients grow and help mature the market.
Mark, you had the wonderful fortune of starting your firm 12 years ago, a year or two right before the great financial meltdown. Take me back to the time when the market was in turmoil. What was it like at Esposito Securities back in 2008, 2009?
Well, you know, contrary to popular belief in most other firms, a few of which we all know went out of business, Esposito did very well, and there was two reasons why. One, there was a lot of volatility in the market, and when there's volatility, there's trading, and we're a trading shop. So we did very well during that period. Additionally, the concern about Esposito being a small shop kind of waned and waxed, because when you have Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns go out of business, that whole "we're bigger and better" product knowledge idea goes straight out the door. And so those were some of our best years. I would hate to see the market do bad or anyone go out of business, but I can say with certainty that we would do much better during that period.
Well, Mark, with that, we'll have to leave it there. Tremendous insight today into certainly a unique part of the ETF ecosystem. Thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure, and have a blessed day, guys.
That was Mark Esposito, CEO of Esposito Securities. Let's take a break, and when we come back, We'll be joined by Alpha Architects Ryan Curlin. We're going to discuss so-called smart beta ETFs. So Ryan is on a mission to try and kill this term smart beta. We'll find out why, and we'll also discuss the pros and cons of ETFs falling into this broad category. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime, Nate and Jason in studio. We now have Ryan Curlin, head of capital markets at Alpha Architect, on the line with us from Philadelphia. If you're not familiar with Alpha Architect, they currently offer five ETFs. Those ETFs have over $500 million invested in them. And Alpha Architect has really hung their hat on taking a systematic, high conviction approach to investing. Their ETFs focus on the value and momentum factors. They're all about delivering high active share, real exposure to these factors. But I've got to tell you, what I really like about Alpha Architect is just how they approach investor education. They take it extremely seriously. They try to get out and dispel investment myths, shoot down false narratives, and really just bring overall visibility to important issues for investors. Ryan himself, he's been in the ETF business for a while now. He was previously part of the ETF group at the New York Stock Exchange, where he actually helped launch over 600 ETFs. He was also head of capital markets at Revenue Shares, who was eventually sold to Oppenheimer. But Ryan is an excellent all-around ETF resource, and we're certainly excited to focus in on smart beta ETFs today. Ryan, welcome to ETF Prime.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So Ryan, when I just said that term, smart beta, did that trigger a gag reflex for you?
It's getting there. It's really about the history of the smart beta that gets me. It was a good term originally, but in more recent history, it's kind of moved away from that to a more opaque term.
Well, let me provide some context here for our listeners. So you recently wrote a piece at alphaarchitect.com titled "Smart Beta is Officially Dead, but Not Forgotten." And you've made it pretty clear you're no fan of the term smart beta. In the piece, you said, quote, "Smart beta is and always has been a marketing term. And from an investment process standpoint, smart beta is and always has been active investing with an algorithm." So boil this down for us. What's your beef with smart beta?
Yeah, so it's really about the history of it, right? And marketing is not a dirty word. Sales is not a dirty word, right? Every industry in the world, we have to do sales. But the issue comes around. So when I was at the New York Stock Exchange, I left in 2013 to join a firm, Revenue Shares. And at the time, the New York Stock Exchange was kind of the center of the ETF universe in a sense, and that we were the only place you could list ETFs at the time. So we kind of got to see everything that came through. And the word smart beta was not really a buzzword yet. But then fast forward to 2013, around the time when I joined Revenue Shares, and it became this the buzzword of the industry. Now, but the thing is, why? Why did it become the buzzword of the industry? And it was really interesting. So in 2012, 2011, if you walked into a financial advisor's office as an ETF salesperson you said, you tried to explain that you did something different than market cap weighting, you got a confused look on your face, because the entire asset management world, when you said ETFs, you said we do low cost, tax efficient, passive investing. Like, that's what they heard. It was one and the same. ETFs equals low cost market cap weighted passive investing. Got it. So smart beta came about as this way to just simply differentiate for this small group of companies. There were about five original ETF companies that did smart beta, just a way to walk into financial advisors and just break that mindset in their head. ETFs aren't only anymore market cap weighted. There's other things we do now in market caps. And that was good, right? So that helped the industry grow. Now, as we've gotten away from that, though, smart beta has just become butchered to the point of meaninglessness, and it's added opacity, it's added opaqueness to the industry. And so really my point is, at this point, investors are educated enough now. Let's just tell them what we do.
All right. So I'm going to go a little Jerry Springer here. I have a clip I want to play for you. We had Bloomberg's Eric Balchunas on the show last week, and he actually mentioned you by name and offered his own thoughts on a smart beta. Take a listen to this.
Ryan Curlin over at Alpha Architect thinks, stop saying smart beta. Just say what you do. Are you equal weighted? Are you this? Are you that? I think you can do both. I think, you know, smart beta could be this sort of big circus tent that houses all kinds of different strategies. Just so us as humans trying to communicate quickly, I could just say, well, it's smart beta. And you'll know immediately that it's not market cap weighted. It does something different. And then if you're interested, we can then tell you specifically what it does. But I think smart beta is, you know, buzzwords and these things, as shallow as it is, they help in communicating more complicated things quickly. So I think it can live while we also can educate and be specific about the product. So I personally think they should be thankful. The quant should be thankful they got this buzzword from heaven that has helped draw attention to them. ESG people would kill for something like that.
Which, as a side note, we actually talked about another one of your favorite topics earlier in the program. We covered ESG ETFs with ETF.com's Drew Voros. But in any event, I do think Eric has a point there in that if an ETF is labeled as smart beta, at least you know it's a strategy that's non-market cap weighted, right? It's doing something different than plain vanilla. Isn't there at least some benefit to that to investors?
I don't think anymore. I think there was a benefit to that, and now investors are just educated enough, largely thanks to the internet, the amount of resources you're able to now educate yourself on. That there's no benefit, and so transparency, because really what it comes down to, transparency is a core culture of ETFs, like the ETF industry in general. And what do I mean when I say transparency is a core part of the culture? That's kind of some fuzzy talk, but that's what we want to get away from. But in the most recent SEC order, which is going to bring about a whole host of changes to the ETF industry, almost all positive in my opinion, but the word transparency is used by the SEC 69 different times within that order. And people will say, it's required by SEC rules for ETFs to be transparent, right? Every ETF publishes their daily holdings on their website. That's required. And that's not true. Almost all ETFs currently provide full transparency by publishing their daily holdings on their websites every day, but they're not required to do so. Only actively managed ETFs and some index-based ones are actually required to publish their daily holdings. Every other ETF company just does it because it's part of the culture. And then smart beta is just too much of a fluff word. It's like, tell me what you do. The investors can now understand. Do you do equal weighting? Cool. Do you do volatility weighting? Do you do you have a value screen on your fund, a momentum screen, whatever it may be? Just tell me. That is, to me, much clearer. Oh, you're a value-weighted fund. Got it. You're a smart beta? What's that mean?
Yeah, so to be clear, your solution is you just want fund companies to tell investors exactly what they're doing with the funds. I mean, is that really what this boils down to?
Yeah, and I think you can do it just as quickly. Again, valuating. If I tell you we do valuating, that doesn't, there's still a lot more to talk about, but you generally understand, okay, you're buying low-cost companies. Got it. As opposed to if I tell you we're doing smart beta, that's just so general. You're just trying to ride like a wave. I just want it more transparent.
Our guest is Ryan Curlin, head of capital markets at Alpha Architect. Ryan, whatever we call these strategies, let's talk a little bit about due diligence, right? Doing your homework in this space. I think for any investor, it can be pretty difficult to wrap their head around all of the options out there. And it seems like new options come to market every day. What do you think are some of the most important things investors should consider as they look at, non-market cap weighted ETFs?
Yeah. You want to look at the process. So it all comes down to the process. And again, then to get away from just the marketing side of it, which is difficult. The good thing, again, is there are so many free tools on the internet available now, again, largely provided by ETF issuers. That's another thing where I talk about the transparency of the ETF culture, or transparency is part of the ETF culture. Right? You can go to iShares website, you can go to Vanguard's website, State Street, WisdomTree, they all have these free tools. Alpha Architects, we have free tools that you can use to analyze your portfolios. I had this is the most incredible story. I had a prospect I was talking to in St. Louis, and they were a large billion-dollar RIA, and their largest client walked into them and put down 10 low-cost ETFs on the table as a portfolio and compared it to what that advisor had had them in for the past 10 years. And they said, this portfolio crushes what you've had me in for the past 10 years. What am I paying you for? And the incredible thing about that story isn't like ETFs versus mutual fund, that's whatever. But the incredible thing is that that regular everyday person, not somebody who worked in the financial industry, was able to do that, right? Because in 2018, you can do that. You can go on Yahoo Finance and generally get a portfolio together. In 1995, there was no way you were going to be able to like build a back-tested portfolio and figure out how you perform versus what your advisor had had you in for the past 10 years. So you just really want to use those free tools. We're big proponents on ensuring that you get value for what you're actually paying for. And by that, we typically mean staying away from closet indexing. You know, you kind of want to go one or the other, either invest in a high active share manager or invest in low cost, but don't get caught in the middle.
Ryan, you mentioned closet indexing, and I know this is something that Alpha Architect has spent a lot of time on, trying to educate investors whether or not they have true factor exposure. And I hate to pick on, you know, any single ETF, but if you look at something like the Goldman Sachs Active Beta U.S. Large Cap Equity ETF, GSLC, that thing has like $4 billion invested in it. And if you look at the underlying factor exposure, I mean, at the end of the day, it's really a closet index fund. How big of a problem do you think that is in the again, quote unquote, smart beta ETF space?
Yeah, it's not necessarily a problem. It's only a problem if the investors that are in it understand or don't understand. And you know, so when we talk closet indexing, what does that mean? Well, if you have, let's say, a value screen and you screen out from a universe of 1,000, you're like, okay, we're going to screen out the top 500 cheapest stocks based off of value. Well, what does that actually get you? If you screen out the top 500, that basically gets you market returns, even though you're screening out the top 500. Why? Well, we always talk about value, like in us, we talk about momentum, but all these other factors, low volatility. If you actually read the academic studies tell you, okay, these factors outperform. What do they do, though? Anytime you're reading those papers, they're screening out the top decile. So they're screening out the 10% cheapest names, right? The bottom 10%, which in that hypothetical example would be then the top 100 cheapest companies, right? As opposed to the top 500 cheapest companies. So a closet indexing would build you the top 500 cheapest names instead of the top 100, the top 10%. And that's really the issue in that you're attaching this academic result to your saying by using the saying we're value factor, but in reality you're only screening out the top 50%. You're not delivering what the academic research says to do. Now, what's the trade-off? Well, typically, if you follow the academic research and screen out only the top 10%, it causes a very volatile, bumpy ride because it's just more concentrated investing. As Wes Gray, the head of our firm, always says, you can end up getting your face ripped off. But the trade-off is in expectation, you may get higher returns.
Ryan, this is Jason Lank. We've got about 3 minutes left. I wanted to touch back on the due diligence process and maybe some of my sort of mild growing skepticism. I see hundreds of so-called smart beta ETFs launched, and I think, how do they come to market? And it just seems as if whatever they're looking for, you know, they torture the data till it confesses, it backtests well, and it comes to market with a story. And a lot of them don't seem to have rationale as to why things work. Is there any truth to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think so. The issue is you can, exactly the word you use, you can torture the data to get a result, right? And you can sit there and be like, all right, let's click that button again in this Excel spreadsheet. Now we equal weight. How does it look now? Or now we do this, you know, and change one thing, and now you get better results. And you can continue to go down that rabbit hole and just keep clicking buttons to keep reformulating the data to add 20 bps, add a percent, right, in the expected returns. But if there's no economic intuition, it becomes really hard to define if you're actually improving the portfolio or if you're just getting lucky by data mining. The key things that you want to look for, you're never going to see a bad backtest, right?
Right.
If an issuer is building a backtest and it doesn't look good, well, they're not bringing it to market. So everything looks good. Starting with that as an assumption, though, how can we know which backtests seem to be more robust? You want persistent. You want to be able to see these out of sample. You want to be able to see them, things that outperform across asset classes all over the world and every data sample that you can get your hands in, not just, on one simple data set, right? And that's kind of the thing with the kind of king factors that have been proven pretty well with momentum and value and some of the other factors is every data set people can get their hands on, these factors show up. When we start to get into murkier stuff, it may not actually be there out of sample.
Ryan, we got about 60 seconds left before we let you go. And unrelated, I did want to ask you about an event this weekend. I know Wes Gray and the entire Alpha Architect team put a lot of time into supporting. It's called March for the Fallen. Can you just quickly tell us a little bit about this event and how Alpha Architect became involved?
Yeah, so we have a big military culture at Alpha Architect. Wes was in the Marines. Our COO, Pat Cleary, was in the Marines. Just big military culture. The point of the event is it's a physical memorial. It's only $35 to sign up to do, but it's an absolutely grueling event. It's a 28-mile hike with a 35-pound pack in Fort Indian Town Gap, which is the middle of Pennsylvania. And every mile you walk by, there's a picture of a fallen service member from the Pennsylvania National Guard who died in either Iraq or Afghanistan to remind you of their sacrifice. That's kind of the point. Not to raise money, just to be a physical memorial.
Well, Ryan, really appreciate you joining us on the program today. And good luck on your mission to kill the term smart beta. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
That was Ryan Kerlin, head of capital markets at Alpha Architect. And again, you can read his blog by visiting alphaarchitect.com. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at etfprime.com, etf.com, iTunes, and Spotify. You can follow me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Next week, we'll be joined by John Mayer, Chief Investment Officer at GlobalX. We'll talk thematic ETFs. And then we'll also be joined by Phil Bock, CEO of Exponential ETFs. We're going to get his take on Bitcoin ETFs. Phil is very well versed on the regulatory side of the equation. So we're going to get his perspective on what's occurred so far in trying to get Bitcoin ETFs approved and what may happen here as we head down the road. Until then, have a great week, everyone.